So, you own a PS Vita and you're thinking about picking up a Nintendo Switch. It's okay, I'm not here to judge. There's no reason why you can't own more than one portable gaming console. Because when you look at it, the games is what's most important. And there's no denying, the Switch has games. They might not be the games you want to play, but there are games. New and relevant ones at that. With its growing sales and popularity, the selection of titles is only going to get bigger. So if you don't see something you like now, just wait a few more months. If you're a current owner of a PlayStation Vita and have finally decided to take the plunge into the land of Switch, then here's a few things you should keep in mind. Number 1. No trophy support. Yup, say goodbye to that beautiful ping sound you've been hearing all these years. I was obsessed with trophies when they were first introduced on the PlayStation 3. Having felt some form of accomplishment after getting the platinum, it gave me a reason to keep playing a game even after completing the story. It was fun at first, since only a select few games had trophy support, but as time went on, the feature became universal. Before I knew it, every game on a Sony console had trophies. This is when it became too much. Getting all the trophies became somewhat of an obligation for me for some reason. I wasn't able to enjoy games as much anymore. Eventually, I just gave up on trophies altogether. So the fact that Nintendo Switch doesn't have this feature isn't that big of a deal to me. I know some of you guys out there love the whole trophy achievement system, and that's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. Just know that if you're coming over to the Switch, you won't have anything like that. At least, not anytime soon. Number 2. More buttons. But to be more specific, L2 and R2. The PS Vita came so close to delivering that true console experience with its introduction of the second analog stick. There was just a few things missing. The first being a second set of shoulder buttons. Fighting games on the Vita found a way to work around this issue with varying degrees of success, but I think the genre that could have benefited the most from extra shoulder buttons were FPS games. Not only were the L2 and R2 buttons missing, there's actually two more buttons I don't hear many people talk about. Did anyone forget about the L3 and R3? They're not quite separate buttons, but more like extra functions to the left and right analog sticks. These are usually the buttons you press in to either run or go into a crouch. It can also be used to realign the camera or perhaps bring up a map. With these buttons missing on the Vita, most secondary actions were mapped to either the front or back touchscreen. Their omission from most Vita games weren't too noticeable. It's only when you start using remote play with the PS4 do you realize how much these extra buttons were needed. On the Switch, you get exactly what you would normally get if you were playing on a console. It's the best of both worlds. The portability of a handheld combined with the control interface of a console. No longer will we have to settle for less buttons. True console gaming on the go is finally here. Number 3. No party chat. One of the most underrated features of the PlayStation Vita was being able to send an invite to a friend and instantly talk to them through the built-in microphone. No extra equipment or messing around with the settings. Simply hit the send button and off you go. Unfortunately, things aren't quite as clear-cut on Nintendo Switch. From my understanding, there's two ways to go about getting voice chat to work on the Switch. One method is to download the Nintendo Switch Online app onto your phone. Accepting and inviting friends to chat will be done through the phone, I think. I couldn't exactly find a clear answer online. About 9 Nintendo Switch games support this voice chat option. I was about to download the app and try out the voice chat myself when I realized, you know what? I don't think I want to stress myself out like that. The other option is to simply plug a headset into the headphone jack on your Switch. This is the easiest solution, but apparently there's only one game that actually supports this type of chat, which is Fortnite. I got a chance to try it out the other night, and I'm actually surprised at how well it works. Audio coming from the other end sounds pretty clear. It's a shame that only one Switch game offers voice chat in this way. I don't know why Nintendo has to make things so complicated sometimes, but I guess they make it up for it in other ways. Number 4. No proprietary memory cards. One of the contributing factors to the low sales of the PlayStation Vita were overpriced memory cards. Those things were expensive. Some were priced as high as the actual Vita itself. I stayed with a 4GB card for the longest time because I simply refused to spend that much money on a memory card. It wasn't until recently that I finally gave in and bought a 16GB card. If you're going to the Switch, this won't be a problem as microSD cards is what you'll be using. The prices of these cards are extremely affordable. I suggest at least 128GB or higher as they can fill up pretty quickly. Number 5. Less portable. If you're planning on bringing your Switch with you on the go, you might want to think about buying a case. Although it doesn't fit into your back pocket like the Vita, there is an upside, a bigger screen. The current model sits at around 6.2 inches, with the Switch Lite releasing in a few months at 5.5 inches. Either way you look at it, it's still bigger than the Vita. Believe it or not, I feel like this is one of the main reasons why a lot of gamers are hesitant to pick up a Switch. It's just not portable enough for them. Honestly, if I don't have to lug around a TV, then that's portable enough for me. Number 6. No OLED. Depending on what model of the Vita you're rocking, you will lose that beautiful OLED screen. That's not to say the Switch screen looks bad, far from it. With a resolution of 1280 by 720p while playing handheld, you will notice a jump in image detail versus the Vita's native 960 by 544. A lot of third-party ports look and ran like crap on the PS Vita, regardless of the type of display, but the games that took advantage showed you what that OLED screen could really do. Games like Muramasa Rebirth, Dragon's Crown, Tearaway, Killzone Mercenary are prime examples. Still, with the loss of the OLED display, the larger screen and higher resolution on the Switch more than makes up for it. Number 7. Improved battery life. Not to be confused with the Switch Lite, Nintendo announces a newer Switch model coming out in mid-August. But unlike the Switch Lite, this model won't be seeing a size reduction. Instead, it'll have a much longer battery life, one that's even longer than the Switch Lite, which, in all honesty, is a little confusing. Wouldn't you think the Switch Lite would be the one with the improved battery? This newer model, which is based off the current model, will have a battery life of around 4.5 to 9 hours, which puts it almost on par with the PlayStation Vita. Going forward, I don't want to hear any more complaints about the Switch having poor battery life. Number 8. No free online. Well, it was bound to happen sooner or later. Nintendo introduces their own yearly subscription for online play. You're given the ability to voice chat, but only a handful of Switch games support this feature. You're also able to back up your saved data to the clouds, but again, not all games support this feature either. Special bonuses are given out to subscription members, like exclusive product sales and even free games. In my opinion, the two biggest reasons to sign up would be, of course, for the online play, but also for the classic Nintendo games. You're given a handful at first, with new titles added each month. The emulation runs extremely well, and they look great while playing in portable mode. Instant save states is also a huge plus, allowing you to start off exactly where you last stopped. There's even a useful rewind feature, which lets you retry those annoying jumps. Most of the games work fine with the standard Joy-Con buttons, but for a more authentic feel, you might want to invest in a Hori D-pad, or wait for the Switch Lite. There's also the option to play these games online. I was under the impression that you can join any available game, but I think it's just games that people on your friends list are playing. So if you don't have a lot of friends who play the NES games online, or if you don't have friends in general, this probably isn't going to work. My only complaint with this is the game selection. Most of the titles include special editions of the original game. Like, do we really need two versions of Mighty Bomb Jack? Can they at least renew the Ninja Turtles license and give us the Turtles arcade game? Now that would be awesome to play online. I know it's tough having to pay for something you got for free on the PlayStation Vita, but look at it this way. How much longer do you think Sony is going to keep the servers up for Vita games? With a larger installed base on the Switch, there's just more people to play with. Simple as that. And of course, the best part. It's only $20 a year. Even if you factor out the voice chat and cloud saving, that's well worth it for online play and access to the NES Classic Collection. Who knows? They might even add SNES support further down the line. Number 9. More games. Like, do I even need to explain this one? That's the benefit of having a console that sells. Developers are willing to support, which in turn gives us more games to play. A lot of the titles so far have been criticized for being ports of older games, but the truth is, most Switch owners haven't played them yet. And yes, Resident Evil 4 is worth $30, even without the motion controls. That game is so awesome. And the fact that they managed to sell is an indication that there still is a market for these games. Plus, it's portable! Not only are Switch owners starting to get third-party ports found on other consoles, there's enough first-party games available now and in the near future that finally makes the Switch worth owning. Number 10. Acceptance. This isn't really a feature of the Switch, but just something to keep in mind as you're making the transition over to Nintendo's handheld. It's not so much for Nintendo fans, but more for the hardcore PS Vita fans. I know picking up the Switch was a difficult decision, but trust me, you made the right move. There's a whole world of games out there waiting for you. Realize that it's okay to have two dedicated handheld devices. The Sony gods are not going to get angry or upset with you. Imagine if the Switch did so well that maybe somehow it inspired Sony to want to release another portable console. I mean, wouldn't you want to see a successor to the PS Vita? Let's show them that there's still a market left for handheld gaming. So now that you made up your mind, let's have some fun. For more Switch-related content, click on the next two videos. If you're new to the channel, consider subscribing. Do that and you'll help me buy more games to talk about. Later.